Welcome, audience, to the One Cell, One Light radio show with your host, Dr. Hildegarde Staninger, commonly known as Dr. Hildy. Today's show, which is going to start our holiday season through the month of December in the year 2011, I have a very special guest and colleague who I've met years ago, and she's gone through many changes, just as I have, and her name is Miss Kathryn Peters-Brinkley. She is author of the book Jewels of the Soul and founder of the online publication Kinetics Magazine, and she's going to discuss with us, which is a major topic for all of us, is spiritual integrity and telling it like it is. But she comes from the aspect of how to maintain spiritual integrity, because many times you can cross the path of compromise, and the question is, how big is that compromise, and does it affect your spiritual integrity? I appreciate you coming on the show with me, Kathryn, and I'm looking forward to sharing the aspects of spiritual integrity and telling it like it is to our audience. And we're very fortunate, audience. Kathryn's going to be on the show for the both hours, so we're going to learn a lot today. And thank you again, Kathryn.
Thank you so much for having me, Dr. Hildy, and thank you for doing the excellent work that you are doing in the world through your
thank
program.
Thank you. I appreciate that we're trying to get the information out and have, as I call it, the Scholars Club, which you would be the scholar of spiritual integrity. And it's all coming good, because I love it when it's archived, and our producer, Lynn, does beautiful in getting the video together, as I call it. I love that. It's like watching a movie. It's my treat over the weekend to watch them.
Oh, how wonderful. And I know anybody in my particular circle that wasn't able to listen today because they were at work or they had other obligations, it's good to know that they can go back to your archives and hear it whenever they need to or whenever
right.
they can.
Right. And with these new iPhones and stuff like that, even though they may have high EMF or anything, but they're very convenient when you're, like, even cooking. You just hit it and watch the movie, as I call it, while you're cooking away. So, Kathryn, for the audience, some of the audience will know what spirituality is, some will not. Let's take it from the basics, if you don't mind, so that then they can understand what is the aspect of spiritual integrity and all of its auspices.
Well, this particular subject, spiritual integrity, is one that is very near to my heart. As a spiritual teacher, a mother of six, and a friend to many, I've witnessed the devastation of lives through the lack of spiritual integrity. And I just want to say first, before we get into exactly what that means, as we journey toward Galactic Center, and I know you know this, Dr. Hildy.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And this 26,000-year pilgrimage that our planet and each of us has been on comes to an end. Everything that is not firmly anchored in integrity will be showing up in our lives now, either to be modified or for us to eradicate it. Because those lower, dense energies cannot find a place and sustain in the higher realms of light and consciousness that we're moving towards.
Right, and that is so true, audience. If you can see in your own life that even if it's a personal relationship or business or just things not working right, it not necessarily is you. It's you not being able to see the spirituality of it and how it's just not fitting, because it's like a square peg trying to get in a round circle. It's just not going to fit unless you remold it. And the remolding is through that spiritualness. It's like if you look at it from a spiritual side, Kathryn, of even just looking at ignorance, meaning one is to have positive ignorance when you absolutely don't know, and you know that you don't know. It's like not committing
exactly.
the sin. You, it's your innocence. You don't know. But you haven't done anything wrong. That's where you can have a contrite heart, et cetera, and see miracles happen. Versus if you have negative ignorance, is when you don't know, but you think you know, and you're determined to get it to work out when it's absolutely wrong.
Exactly.
Because of that ignorance. You know, neither one are right or wrong, but the thing is that if you keep going and it's not working, it's the time audience. And I don't know if you agree with me, Kathryn, but it's just like you said with the galactical center coming into the center, the pilgrimage,
mm-hmm.
which is the bond of heaven and earth. And in that
right.
bond and that energy clearing, the thing is, this lower dense thing, hey, if you can't teach someone spirituality or anything, they got to have it in their heart and want to expand. You know, it's like, hey, take the book, open it up and get some knowledge, not throw it on the ground and expect to absorb it. Because you haven't even opened up your ESP gate, you know? So
exactly, exactly.
It's
well,
just
in many
hard.
Ways, the,
go ahead.
In
go
many
ahead.
Ways, the last 26,000 years, as far as humanity has been concerned, has been meant to help us on our personal journey of self-discovery and moving into understanding ourselves as divine humans. So that ignorance that you're talking about is people not understanding that they are spiritual in nature. They are divine by design. But we have come here to Earth to discover that divinity within us. And it isn't easy. It certainly isn't easy since we entered this period of shift where there has been so much coming at us, so much that we created in folly and in ignorance that now must be eradicated so that we can step into the new age. And that's mm-hmm. where our spiritual integrity comes into play. And,
right.
and the things that we're going to talk about today that people can do to develop or increase their spiritual integrity.
Yeah, which I personally feel, this is my own personal opinion, not even as a profession, just me as Hildy, okay, that you have to have, in the changes that are happening in this world where we have artificial biology, I mean, I even read an article that I'm going to do a show on where they took the protein from a fungus and made it into a form of like chicken nuggets, you know, it's just amazing, but then people got sick from it because it had the mycotoxins in it, you know, because now you can't even get them tested for unless it's only 20 different compounds. But it's a long story. But you think you're buying something, and it's even artificial biology, meaning it was made in a vat and put into a mold, so it looks like a chicken or it looks like some kind of food, okay, versus that, I'm just using it, I'm not stretching it, but using that as an example, meaning that type of clone operation or that type of manufacturing operation, I would feel that it doesn't even have the soul of the animal, you know, or the group soul.
Exactly.
It doesn't have the emotional life. It doesn't have anything. It's just supposed to be a nutrient base. So how can you heal? It's like healing with medicinal plants or eating like whatever the food may be, even mangoes or anything, you have that life force of that plant into your body so that you can expand, you know, and basically it builds up your radiant heat, et cetera, which is a whole different show. But the thing is that in society now, because of all the changes or the integration of a lot of work that I've done in the nano or anything, it's clogging up the cell to really communicate correctly, also detox properly or anything. It's just making it harder on everything. And the thing is, so that then if you did have spirituality, it is just like you said, Kathryn, you have to bring that higher. You have to bring it so that you can keep your sanity and at the same time know that there will be an end. Versus if you bite the bullet that you give up or you go down below to the lower vibration, you will just be engulfed. And if you want a chip in your body, that's a whole other story, you know?
Yes, exactly. Exactly. And just the point that you've made about how far science has come, that we can take a fungus and make it a chicken nugget, this is very scary, just the whole prospect of it. And many spiritual experts believe that we are at the point where we're at the same place Atlantis was in the final days, where our technology has transcended our spiritual maturity, gone way beyond it. And because we don't have the spiritual maturity to understand how to most effectively and positively use our science or our technology, we stand at the threshold of possibly even eliminating this planet, destroying ourselves, because especially because of our weapons of mass destruction.
Right. And
so we have to maintain spiritual integrity to see that that does not happen.
Right, and that spiritual integrity and that maturity of that is not just in our everyday person or anything. It has to happen from the bottom to the top and the top to the bottom. No matter what your field of work is, what you are, home, as I call it, domestic engineer, whatever. It needs to happen. It needs the heart to open and needs it to happen now, not next month, not any time. Because these are major things that are happening, and I, as a scientist and pioneered in some of these aspects of identifying, I'm going to call it, unusual stuff in the field, it's getting more and more. It's getting complex. It's getting where tests that are normally available for biological monitoring are no longer available. So proving it, is going to be a little bit harder, but that doesn't scare Dr. Staninger. She just keeps persevering and going forward. But it is just like you said, about Atlantis. When you go into the stories of that and everything, some people will say, hey, it's all mythology and that. But right now we're finding out that mythology must have been true because we can make it in science.
That's right. That's right.
And that is scary.
That is scary. And what's more important is that the next 12 months, basically, as we go from this December to next December 21st of 2012, when the actual alignment happens at the heart of the galaxy, this is the most crucial period for us to step into our destiny as divine humans. After that period, it's going to be a lot more difficult to do.
Right, and it's where you make that commitment, you stimulate yourselves to remember that divinity within yourself, which is all of you, and whether it's just like Jesus said, just a sliver of a twig, just you are part of the wood, you're part of everything within this universe. Whether it's good, bad, or anything, you're just all part of it. The thing is that when you can introduce different compounds that can interfere with structure, that's when you get the baffling. You don't get the signals. Know what's within yourself, and that because you're going to need it. You're going to need it. This I feel this program, and I appreciate you being on, is very important for spiritual food, and it's needed because many of us may have dreams of Atlantis and everything, but at the same time, there is major things that if Plato was true, major things happened there, for the destruction and everything.
Oh, absolutely. And you're right. It's up to every one of us. It doesn't start at the top and work its way down. Everyone, and now there's officially 7 billion of us on the planet or just over, it's important that every one of us assume the responsibility for our spiritual integrity in order to anchor in as much light and love on this planet as we go through the next 12 months as possible.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And it starts with each of us, and then what we teach our children and our friends from there. So when we're talking about integrity, integrity is defined as holding high moral principles and doing the righteous and noble thing no matter what, no matter what anybody else thinks, no matter what anybody else does. We all know what's right and wrong. However, we've come to a point right now on the planet where we believe it's okay to rationalize wrong or unethical behavior. And much of this is done by comparison to what other unethical people are doing. And it's almost as if, it's laughable. We've come to the point where we expect our politicians to be unethical. We expect them to compromise their integrity by telling us lies, by telling us or making promises they never intend to keep. This type of thing is what we have to check. And we can only do it. We can't control what they're doing, of course, except by not voting them into office or voting them out of office. But we have to check it in our own lives. Very often in any given day, we cross that line, as you said in the introduction. And we may not even be aware of it. And that's why programs like this are so important, to just give us that little tap on the shoulder to say, hey, you know, that's not completely in integrity. Let's go back and do that again.
Right, because it will come back and resurface. Mm. It's like you could say, oh, this is a pattern. I'm seeing the same people, but different people's faces or anything. It's because the eternal God within all of us and its connection to universe, the male and the female of it, it's trying to teach you, recognize what happened here, make the right choice, because you always have free will. But if you're not aligned, it's like you will have less free will, I think, you know, because the counterpart of anything good is something bad, or the ultimate evil of it.
Oh, exactly.
Is there an ultimate
evil? If you're
not
aligned,
I'm sorry.
If you're not aligned, you're going to keep making that same mistake over and over, but mm-hmm. every time the consequence gets greater and greater. And then you're right, you do lose control, because you've created this monster that's going to be huge to overcome. You know, we always have a chance to choose again.
Mm-hmm.
We can always
mm-hmm.
choose again. So through this program that we're going to encourage everyone to really look at the choices they're making and why they're making them. Integrity, as we said, is holding high moral principles, but social integrity changes as our consciousness changes. Things that were commonplace, say, 100 or 200 years ago, would not be tolerated today, you know, such as slavery or living without child labor laws, things like that, that were just mm-hmm. a century ago. Now, today, because we have grown in consciousness and understanding, we would never tolerate it. We would never let it happen. But when we're talking about spiritual integrity possesses an inherent constant that is above the confluence of social mores or popular opinion, right?
Mm-hmm.
Spiritual integrity is based on the never-changing qualities of divine principles. And when we have spiritual integrity, we are coming from our authentic selves.
Right.
We are walking our talk. You know, we are doing in public what we do in private. And what we do in private when we think no one is looking is still based in purity and goodness.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where a lot of people have gone wrong these days, including some of our spiritual leaders. You know,
mm-hmm.
they say one thing in public, but they're doing something very different in private. And that's what we have to change.
Right. And through that, as you change it, then you'll get the, I call it the test of the fire, you know, to become the phoenix,
you
as
bet.
I call it, or to make your sword, which is made of stainless steel, and how you make better stainless steel is putting it into the fire so that it attunes that steel so that it is tempered. And
mm-hmm.
when that happens and you have that good mix that way, then you can cut through everything. Just like Alexander did, instead of trying to untie the knots, he just took his sword out and cut right through
mm-hmm.
it and then conquered
exactly.
those lands. And that's what you have to do. You have to conquer your own domain, your own self. I've always viewed as the home, no matter where it is, whether it's an apartment trailer, a mansion, whatever it may be. That is your sanctuary. That is your resting place. That is your domain for yourself. And then
exactly.
aligning it to the spiritual side. And this is so true. When you look in Taoism and that, and you have your, you know, as we come from a star, that you have your physical self here and the other part of you out in space, which is
mm-hmm.
the star, that it is aligning that. As you align Earth to the center of its own core, all the fallout, which is yourself aligned to yourself, which then is just like in I believe it's Michelangelo D'Angelo, where it has the man is the X, you know, the spread
mm-hmm.
eagle hands and
yes,
legs.
Yes.
That is like an hourglass. You are the bridge to heaven and earth. But if you're not aligned with earth or not aligned with heaven, which can be your spiritual self, and we know it goes into other aspects, you're going to have a screwball effect, you know, meaning...
Absolutely.
You know, that
and
way...
And then that's going to have a domino effect in
yes.
your life and in the lives of everyone that you touch.
Right. And
so spiritual integrity means being true to yourself and to what you deem most important in your life, mm-hmm. to the point of being unwavering. You know, in this way, we are deeply committed to our spiritual principles.
Right. And you know, so many people, you know, one is to commitment, and this is, I call it the compromise. It's not right. When you talk the talk, walk the walk, and look the look, you are committed to it. You're committed to the death and to the fire, okay? And that's where that individual is coming from. But in these sacrifices, what, you know, I've always said health is the most precious of, you know, your commodities within yourself, because
right.
if you don't have health, you don't have anything. But if you don't have the health to maintain your true spirituality, because that's what's needed now, you know, for your higher self, you will not have the true wealth of the kingdom or the universe. And without that, you will have the hardest journey that you ever had, I think, as these times change within this next 12 months.
Yes, especially. You know, in the years gone by, I have often lectured about remembering who we are. And this is very important, I think, for your audience to hear as well. We decided, in my opinion, to come to the earth to be the essence and presence of love. And when we live in our spiritual integrity and consider what love is bringing to any situation, any circumstance, any relationship, then we are living in our spiritual integrity. So if we can just keep those words in the back of our minds, that we are here to be the essence and presence of love, then no matter what we're doing, whether we're planting a garden, whether we're coming up with a new vaccine, whether we're raising children, we will always be living our divine qualities.
I agree.
Okay. And many people believe that the future of our planet as we go through the next 12 months will be greatly determined by the consciousness of humanity, whether we brave and survive the uncertainties of traveling into the heart of the galaxy or not. This could be predicated on the collective energy of all of us as we transmit it both into the planet and into the cosmos. Because as we come to center, we are going to be encountering energies of levels we've never sustained, at least not in the last 26,000 years. And we're also going to be facing a black hole.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, as a scientist, you realize all the various things that can happen as we encounter that change in gravity and change in energetics. Some people believe that we could stop our evolution, our revolutions, and go the other way. Some people believe that we could shift on our axis. So many spiritual leaders believe that if we're all on the same page, if we're holding light and love, if we're living in our spiritual integrity, we can actually alter what happens to the planet. Because another part of this 26,000-year phase was for humanity to become aligned with the planet Earth. Now, what have we done instead? We've done a very good job of polluting her and corrupting her, but it's not too late for us to get back in sync with the mother, to take time to go out every day and put our feet in her dirt or sit upon her and send love and healing to the planet. Hug a tree, hold some crystals, go to the beach and give thanks for all that she has given us. These are some of the things that we can do to determine what happens when we reach galactic center.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure there's other things that you can recommend as well.
Yes, but these are primary things, because it's like I've told patients, individuals, even friends, that don't you think it's time, you know, if you're still complaining about what you're, you know, if you're 60 years old or 70 years old and you're still complaining what happened to you when you were 2 years old, don't you think it's time to get rid of it, you know, let it go, so that you can make new ways into moving forward and letting the past be the past, mourn it, take care of it. But then at the same time, if you keep dwelling on the physical past, you will not have any room for any future because you can't even move into the now.
No, I understand that completely. Yeah, but so many people, like, we'll have this conversation, and they'll say, well, I know all of this. You know, this is fundamental. But if you're not doing it, you really don't know it.
Right, because you're not practicing it.
You're not practicing it on a daily basis, then you really don't understand how vitally important it is, not only for your survival, but for the planet itself.
Right, and I think it's important, too, that we're talking, audience, right now, just in this last conversation, in reference to the physical plane, you, the physical being, okay, of letting go of things in the past to the future. But the thing is that if you don't do some of these exercises we're saying, at the same time, if you hang on, and if you haven't come to the consciousness of saying, okay, if I'm late on this thing, or I'm going to have problems with this, it's as simple as writing a little letter or doing a little phone call and saying, hey, I got a little problem here. It's not my intent, but I'm trying to work it all out. Work with me on it. That's half the battle versus
yes,
not sharing that or whatever that need was with the, I'm going to say, the third party that is responsible for some other actions. It ends up making it more complex because they don't know what's going on, and then their mind starts going. Because we're all very creative with our mind.
Oh, yes, we are. We can make
we can make bad things, we
yeah.
can do any of this.
Yeah.
And the thing is, and I learned this when we did these genetic tests, and when people were able to do their genes of what nationalities they were in their bloodlines, but we'd use the saliva, mm-hmm. it told them who they were in humanity. When they knew who they were in humanity and even read some humanities books to what happened during those civilization timelines and stuff and who battled water, et cetera, it was allowed them to me, let go of their role of humanity. They saw themselves as one. Because you may think you're only one nationality or two, and in reality you got 67 nationalities behind you. Or you had the most ancient gene, an allele that was known to be 4 million years old. Turn around, you're a part of the beginning of something, you know, that's older than maybe the humanity as we know it. But to have that gene allele, you had to have a high enough frequency or spirituality, because I'm looking at that's in the spiritual realm, that of that energy field to even contain that, even if it's just one molecule or one cell versus the whole being. No matter what your temple is, which is your body, to maintain your radiance, which is, to me, your fingerprint of your soul, you know, meaning how much far infrared you have and how much light you have. Or remember, far infrared has no photons, so the amount of that energy field. Turn around, it's where whatever that measurement is also needed to contain what is needed when you align the higher self. But if you haven't gotten rid of your garbage, you know, even your toxins within your body or even your emotional garbage, you know, which happened when you were 2 years old or whatever. The thing is, it won't allow the alignment to go on straight.
Exactly.
At least in my opinion.
No, I agree with you completely. I agree with you completely. And for the sake of our discussion today, I have compiled the spiritual integrity top 10.
I think we
need to put into conscious daily practice no matter what. And I invite you to, you know, give me your suggestions, or I don't know if, you know, if anyone listening. Do you have callers who call in?
We do have callers that call in, but they haven't called in. So it ends up being
an
archive show. But we can we will add those 10 top 10 spiritual integrity items to the show, and we'll even have it printed out on the Vimeo so we can do it one at a time with the appropriate pictures or anything. Anything to support
the cause.
I was
just inviting them to call in and add to the list because, you know, these are 10 things in no particular order, but, you know, everyone I know has their own idea of what is really important to live an authentic life based on spiritual integrity. But the first thing that I think is most important, and then after that it really isn't in any particular order, is prayer, meditation, and affirmation. Because we live in a time that is so chaotic. We are being bombarded from so many directions by so much information, more than ever before, that it's easier than ever to get off center. And prayer, meditation, and affirmation helps to bring us back to center. And I wrote a book, this is so important to me, that I wrote a book of affirmations that you mentioned at the beginning of the show. Mm-hmm. It's called Jewels for the Soul. I wrote this book back in 1992, but it is timeless because it is a book of spiritual reflections and affirmations. And I keep it on the coffee table. Either I open it or the children run for it every day. Say, you know, pick your jewel for the day. And before I did the radio show, I always do a little meditation and open the book. And I thought this was just so uncanny, yet it just shows me how timely or timeless this book is, because when I opened it for the show today, I got Being Loyal to My Word. And I'd like to share this with you, if you don't mind.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes, please.
This is page 225 of Jewels for the Soul. My jewel for today is being loyal to my word. There have been times when I said something just because I thought it was what someone needed to hear. I didn't say it because it was heartfelt or because I planned to back it up with any real action. I simply wanted to stroke an ego or smooth a few ruffled feathers. While this kind of behavior may be expeditious, it is not genuine. It manifests no honor in my spoken word. By being loyal to my word, I eliminate the need for a great many future apologies. And the affirmation is, every time I open my mouth, sweet spirit, please help me to utter only those words to which I can be loyal.
So true, so true.
And that goes along with what we were saying today. So these are my affirmations, and I believe, I certainly encourage anyone to pick up Jewels for the Soul, but I believe that affirmations are very important. Because, as I said earlier, we're being bombarded every minute of the day by what's going on in the world around us, and we're very easily pulled off center. So by having affirmations from a book like mine or writing your own and keeping them posted where you can see them, that helps us to stay centered. It helps us to stay positive, and it reminds us to think the most positive and beautiful thoughts possible, because where our thoughts go, there go our lives.
Right, right. And the whole thing with Jewels of the Soul, it's something that you can do as a part of your daily meditation or to start off the day with.
I start off the day with it. I do that before I do my meditation. And for many people, they think they don't have time to meditate, but I want to say you can't afford not to. And the meditation doesn't have to be in a quiet place with closed eyes and crossed legs. You can do a walking meditation. I know people who meditate while they swim. It's just a matter of emptying the mind and allowing yourself to reconnect and realign with your higher self. And any way that is comfortable for you to do that is okay. It's just important that you do it on a daily basis, because here again, we can get disconnected from that small voice within, from our higher wisdom, from our higher heart so easily by all that the day brings to us to pull us and distract us this way and that.
Right.
And of course, prayer. Go ahead.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is it's so easy to get distraction, you know, especially if you still have, as I call it, monkey chatter in your brain. If you got this thing, you're worried about this formula, or you're worried about, oh, I need to cook turkey now, or, you know, those things, versus keeping your mind clear. And sometimes it's as simple as doing a task, like I always tell a patient or tell a friend, go work in the garden if you can, because once you, you know, get into the soil and everything, you're able to relax your mind. Go to the movies, do sewing, something that just allows you, that is sort of repetitive, or even iron your clothes or anything, so that it relaxes your mind. It doesn't mean that you have to stop being a neurosurgeon. It just means that during that time, that is allowing your mind to relax so that you can align your higher self with yourself.
That's exactly true. And another way that I find I do it throughout the day is listening to music. You know, listening to music that's a very high vibration or very positive sentiment. For me, Ricky Byers Beckwith, I love her music. And also Michael Beckwith has come out with some music called Transcendance that I was gifted a few weeks ago. And it's incredible because all the words are encouraging you to open your heart and feel the love and reconnect with spirit. And to have this going on around you all day long keeps you on an unconscious level plugged in, even if consciously you're going about different tasks.
Right.
So it's just
What I was going to add to it, Kathryn, is that when you have music, like music allows you to relax your mind and to be in it, not only do you hear it with your own ears, but your cells, your body hears it.
Yes.
So it allows them to unfold the proteins. It allows, these are just science terms or anatomy terms, but it allows you to unfold yourself. It's like, here is your most precious gift from God the Creator and any belief system you believe in, that here is my soul. Now I can relax and I can open it up and be me.
Yes.
As
absolutely.
I move into the divine heart. Because
that's what that's all about.
Yeah, because it's like many years ago, when if anyone read the poems and the art writings of Rumi, the Middle Eastern poet and philosopher, the thing is that it's like his poem in reference to chickpeas. You're making chickpea soup, okay? You know, that the first ladles of those, that soup is the most delicious, but then when you get down to the bottom, you've got the bones and everything. So, you know, it's like at the bottom of the pit when you get down to the bottom, you know? We're all made up, that was all chickpea soup, but you don't know what you get when you get at the bottom. So it's clean it all up, you know?
Yeah, clean it all up.
Clean it all
up.
Well,
that's as far as meditation is concerned and affirmation, and then there's prayer. And for me, you know, everyone has their own selected prayers that they like to say, but for those who don't feel they have a lot of time to go into prayer and get on bended knee, I think one of the most effective prayers is just saying thank you and counting our blessings every day in gratitude. It doesn't have to be long and drawn out, but it really is important. For me personally, I start saying thank you from the time my eyes open in the morning, you know, and I'm still here and I'm with my family and my children and my loved ones, and it's thank you so much for another day. Thank you so much for the presence of my loved ones. Thank you for the sunshine, you know, and then you can go on from there to count your blessings. It doesn't have to be anything elaborate or lengthy that you have to memorize. Just come from your heart and give thanks for the life that you have.
And that's so true. And so prayer, meditation, and affirmation, audience, is the first top 10 of Kathryn. What is number 2, Kathryn?
Well, I wanted to share a little story with you
about
how I wrote this book before we move on.
Number 2
is having faith and being of good cheer. But Jewels for the Soul came about after I had a very, oh my goodness, how can I put this, a very huge struggle in my life as far as my health was concerned. And maybe you can even help me with this to have greater understanding of what happened to me. After the birth of my first child, I had some very strange symptoms. I was 21 years old, and after she was born, maybe 6 weeks to 3 months, I started losing feeling in my hands and the tip of my nose. I started having difficulty raising my foot to go upstairs. And so I decided it was time to see the doctor, and my mother was very upset and wanted me to see the best. So she insisted on taking me to the Cleveland Clinic because I live in Nevada, and she didn't think that real doctors wore cowboy boots. So she didn't trust any of the diagnoses here, so she took me to the Cleveland Clinic, and after seeing a panel of different physicians, they all concurred that I was suffering from the beginnings of MS. And for, you know, a 21-year-old, and I guess that age is when it's quite common to be diagnosed, but as the mother of a brand-new baby, this was most disconcerting for me. I really didn't know what to do. At that time, there was no medication. I'm not sure that even Dr. McDougall had the diet book out at that time, but I was determined. And so through prayer and meditation, I feel that I helped to stop the symptoms. However, a few years later, they all came back. And at that time, I was told that the disease was galloping, and before too long, I would be in a wheelchair.
Oh, my.
And the only thing that they could do for me, you know, was to be there when that happened, when I needed the wheelchair or any kind of home care. And, my God, this was devastating. So I stepped up what I was doing, and I do remember getting Dr. McDougall's book on diet for MS and doing my prayer and meditation, but I also put into practice affirmations. I had been introduced to Louise Hay's book, You Can Heal Your
Beautiful
Life.
Beautiful book.
Yes, and I believed I could do it. And through writing out my own affirmations on a daily basis, putting them everywhere, reciting them, you know, 10 times a day, before too long, not only had the symptoms diminished, but I found they were no longer there. And that was well over 20 years ago. And I have not had another symptom since.
Right. And many times with MS, the physical cause can be that you were exposed to different pesticides, especially organophosphate type, malathion, diazinon, or the combination of like pyrethrins that are used in like flea and dog tick collars and stuff, and then exposure to that. That immediately, that can be a chemically induced MS or a lateral
sclerosis. I wondered about that. I never thought about pesticides, but years later when I started thinking that both times the symptoms occurred, it was after a birth of a child. I have six children, but it only happened after the birth of those two daughters, and I was induced. Labor
That's what I was
going to
say. Meaning
both
there could,
times.
In the case, you could have had low cholinesterase, and that affects the nerves. Thus, when you had, usually when they're induced, they use Pitocin, which acts as a cholinesterase inhibitor and brought you all the way down. And that's going through your spinal cord and everything. And even those particular two daughters of yours, they may have trouble with, you know, or had, you know, like allergic responses or anything that might be due to Pitocin, because it's all interrelated at that time. But it could have been at your weakest time. But also with your affirmations, because you were telling your body, you were telling yourself, you're not committing to this situation.
Exactly.
And that is so important. I have seen miracles happen, whether, you know, you want to say, okay, this is the cause, this is this. It's like I tell patients, this caused it, doesn't mean that you can't get rid of it, doesn't mean that you can't turn it around. All you need is one good cell to be good so it can remember what to do and tell the rest, and you got to make that cell your general within your whole body to get those recruits going.
Exactly. I think that's an excellent point that you just made, that I was not committing to that diagnosis. I made up my mind, and I believe had I made up my mind that this is the way it was going to be, I remember at the time my husband said, well, we're going to have to move to a one-story house. We'll have to sell your dream house and move so you don't have to go up and down stairs, and we have bigger pathways for a wheelchair. And if I had committed to that vision, I do believe that's where I would have been.
You're absolutely not. And also, at that time, maybe your, I'm going to call it spiritual integrity, okay, was higher than your mate, your husband at that time. I'm not saying they differ in spiritual, but what I'm saying is yours, you didn't bite that bullet. You didn't take that bullet. You chose another path, and that essence within you allowed you to overcome it. Even though you read Dr. McDougall's book, and that, you know, which has probably in it kelp, dulse, all the different sea vegetables and different green vegetables, so that you can get the nutrients in to help heal the nerves, or lecithin, or honey, or any of these vitamins that is needed to heal the nerves, so that the myelin sheaths repair themselves, go back to normal, the toxins come out. Could have been too. Hey, maybe you had a, not meaning in your home, but maybe in the house before or anything like that, they used lead arsenic to kill rats or anything like that. So the white powder was laying around there. You didn't know what it was, clean it up or anything. And then that gets into your body, coats your nerve or your cells. And then you had maybe chicken pox when you were a kid, thus that viral residue's there. And then you got hit with the pesticide or the Pitocin, you know, when you had the induced labor. But all of those play a role, because it's coating the nerves or coating the cells, so it cannot get the nutrients in, it cannot function properly. But at the same time, what happened to, I'm speaking from a spiritual side, is that your affirmations that you made, that you were committed to yourself to make you the best that you could at that time with the choices that you took, and those affirmations, that you generated your own radiance, your own ability to go to your core to heal within. And then you had the miracle.
Exactly what I did.
You didn't buy the wheelchair, even though you had a very compassionate husband that was designing the whole house to make it for an invalid. But and that was very good, because 20 years ago it was very hard back then for a lot of invalids, even older, you know. But the thing is that it was very compassionate of that person, but at the same time, your faith within yourself and your integrity allowed it to turn it around.
Absolutely, and that's what I want to encourage to anyone who's hearing this, that no matter, you know, what the prognosis is, no matter what you've been told, you have the ability, like you said, if you have just one healthy cell that remembers, and if you set your mind and you say your affirmations, you go into meditation and align with your perfect health, and you pray and give thanks for the most positive outcome, absolute miracles can and will happen.
Right, and as we're getting closer into this core energy field with the galactical shift, which is a fit audience, it is physically happening, you know, proved by NASA et al. It's not where it's woo-woo and just making it up. The thing is that no matter what you do in supplements, what you do in anything, if you can get them, great. But if you put it in your mind that you are your divine self and you want to be the divine radiance of yourself, you'll see years disappear off your face, everything. You have to be committed. You cannot be committed by just thinking about it and then not practicing it. And it's just like you said in the beginning, you look the look, talk the talk, walk the walk. You know, you have to practice what you preach, because it's not going to be tolerated. You know, it's not the time to turn your cheek and look the other way.
Absolutely.
It's the time to be committed. If you can't commit to anything out there, you commit to yourself. If you can't commit to that, then you'll never commit to anything.
Absolutely right. Absolutely right. Spiritual integrity is being true to oneself. And being true to oneself means self-love and the discipline to do whatever it takes to keep the temple, as you said earlier, you know, as healthy and as clean and clear as possible.
Mm-hmm. Because then when you go through these earth changes or any of these things, it can vibrate through you. It doesn't have to have the metals vibrate back to you and make them concentrated, and then you have varicose veins. You don't need that, okay? No one needs that.
But it happens.
But also commit with yourself, and I feel this is a very big affirmation for the world and anyone who hears this show, that commit that you're not going to bite into all this synthetic stuff, because it's not pure. It's not from the heart of creation. It's from the hearts and the creative minds of individuals that I personally feel maybe not even have one molecule of integrity or spiritual integrity, because they run in disciplines of greed, vanity, and just gluttony, trying to get everything they can. You know, it's like, hey, I've got the individual has billions, and then turn around, oh, they still want that one acorn. You know, like that prehistoric squirrel, you know. He's hanging on to it forever. But, it's like, you know, it does exist. And those are the forces that cross everybody's path. And it not necessarily comes from the individual that has the spiritual integrity, but it's the people around them that may not have it. And so that is the weights and the anchors, the hooks that get into you and play with your own heart. Get above it, cut it like Alexander, and get beyond. That's
absolutely
my opinion. I don't know if you
agree with
you.
And that's certainly on the list. It wasn't the next thing I was going to talk about, but I think it's very important that we consciously surround ourselves with like-minded people, with people of the highest spiritual integrity. Now, we can't control all the time, you know, who we work with. But when we're away from work, or perhaps we could even find a job where there are more like-minded people, but in this economy and with unemployment rates being what they are, you know, we might just have to bite the bullet there. But certainly in our friendships and with those relationships in our family, it's so important to surround ourselves with people who are striving on a daily basis to live in spiritual integrity and to raise their vibration through everything that they think, say, and do.
Mm-hmm. It is. It is.
Because it's all about raising the vibration now.
Mm-hmm.
Because we are going into higher realms of love and light, and we have to be ready when we get there.
Mm-hmm. And it's as simple as this, audience. I'm going to put in a little perspective. Example. Say the toilet paper ran out, whether at work or at home, and you just have that empty roll of the paper that holds the toilet paper to it, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Don't wait for the next person to change it out. Change it out yourself. It makes it easier for the next person. That's a little stepping stone to getting on your path of spirituality, because if you can't be conscious of the consequence of actions within the physical realm, you won't open up to the spiritual realm. So it's little acts of kindness that open the doors or pay the piper for putting on the show.
Oh, that's so true. That's so true and so well said. Well, number two on my list is to have faith and be of good cheer. Having faith in a higher power and understanding that everything that's happening in your life is happening for a reason, for a higher purpose. To have this is tantamount to your peace of mind and for finding meaning in your life. And for me, this lesson was driven home when I had my second near-death experience.
Mm.
And I'd like to share a little bit of that with
you. Sure.
I had my first near-death experience when I was just a child, and I drowned in a pond near a friend's summer cottage. And because I was raised in a house that was a bit eclectic, my mother was a good Jewish girl that went to the Methodist church, and my father worked for NASA, so he considered himself an atheist. I think he was more agnostic, but I think, you know, calling himself an atheist was more sensational. And then I had a grandmother who was totally into the arcane wisdom and would hide her monthly horoscope magazine in her closet. And I had a Native American grandfather that did very strange things in the backyard during full moons.
Yes.
So I had, you know, I had this potpourri of religious and spiritual theories going on around me all the time, but I didn't have any frame of reference for a near-death experience. And when it happened at the pond, my friend and I had been jumping off and swimming under a raft that her father had fashioned for us out of 2x4s, nails and wire and so forth. And there was a splinter in the wood on the bottom side of this raft, and I had very long hair that got caught in that splinter of wood. And I couldn't free myself. And the next thing I knew, I was outside of myself, looking at me, dangling there, and thinking, how odd is this? I'm there, but I'm here. I'm here, but I'm there. And the next thing I knew, there was a light coming through the water. And now I understand it was the tunnel forming. But at that time, I had no idea what it was. Before I knew it, I was back on land, and my girlfriend's father was pumping the water out of my lungs. And I never even discussed that with anyone because I just didn't know what to say, and I didn't think of it as the beginnings of the afterlife or that I had even, you know, experienced that out-of-body thing. So that's when I was around 12 years old. Then when I was 29 years old and someone told me this was because of my Saturn return, I was stung in the neck by a bee, and I didn't realize, I never knew that I was allergic to bees, and immediately went into anaphylactic shock.
Mm.
And I remember picking up my son, who was about 18 months old at the time, and just putting him in bed. It was bedtime. He was already in his jammies, and I put him in bed, and I laid down beside him and just lifted out of my body and floated up to this a corner of the room just under the ceiling next to an open window. And I knew that I would be going out of that window and that this chapter of my life would be over. There was no fear of extinction or annihilation. I knew in my beingness that life was forever, life was eternal, but that this particular scene, this particular chapter in my book of life would end. And I had absolutely no problem with that. There was not a moment of concern. As I looked down at my body and my son lying next to me, sleeping peacefully, there was nothing but great peace within me, the kind of peace beyond all understanding that we've heard about or read about in the Bible. Mm. That's where I was at that moment.
And Kathryn, I hear the music in the background. We're going to pick up at this point on the second hour of the show, so please stay
okay.
with us. And audience, we're going to have a little break in between, and we'll pick up you up for the second hour. Okay, audience? And thank you, Kathryn.
Informed. Enlightened. Alive and amplified. This is the Living Light Network.
Welcome back, audience, to the One Cell, One Light Radio with Dr. Hildegarde Staninger, commonly known as Dr. Hildy, and my special guest, Ms. Kathryn Peters-Brinkley. We left our first hour with Kathryn explaining and just getting to the end of her second near-death experience. And, Kathryn, can you pick it up from where you left off?
Yeah,
where you had anaphylactic shock. I can tell you anaphylactic shock, where you lay down with your son. You were approximately 29 years old. You got out of your body. You were in the corner of the room, and you were total peace.
Total peace, total peace.
Total peace, and that's where
we
were. And
as I said, I was looking down at my body and looking down at my son sleeping so sweetly, and I just felt total peace. There was no concern about leaving him or, as I said, going out that window and starting the next chapter of my life or returning to source, whatever I believed was going to happen. But the most beautiful part of that, those few minutes that I was out of my body during the second near-death experience, was that I understood that there was order in the universe. There was divine, perfect order, and that I didn't need to concern myself with what was going to happen in that life or with my son or those that I was leaving behind. I just needed to be concerned with where I was going, because everything was going to be taken care of. And the amount of peace that overcame me was phenomenal. There's no way to describe it.
Mm-hmm.
And the feeling of oneness with everything in the universe. I understood myself. I felt like a big bubble of consciousness that kept growing as each moment went by, and that I was one with everything, with the stars and with the trees outside, with the earth herself. So I enjoyed this time out of my body. And before I knew it, my older daughter, who was 7, was running down the hallway and, Mommy, wake up. Please wake up. Something's terribly wrong. Don't go to sleep. I'm calling Grandma. And she shook me, you know, as roughly as she could, and I was back in my body. And at
right.
that moment, all those human emotions flooded me, came over me, and I almost felt, you know, panicked and hysterical that, oh, my God, I was about to leave, and my son would never know how much I loved him and who was going to take care of my older daughters. And, you know, I was just in this panic mode at that point before my mother came to pick me up and take me to the hospital. So, of course, I found out at that time I was allergic to bees and
mm-hmm.
have to go everywhere now with my EpiPen and be very, you know, conscious and cautious of where I am, especially in the spring and summer. But that taught me, that experience taught me so much. But what I want to convey today is that we must have faith, find faith in a higher power. Anyone who is living today and does not believe that infinite spirit exists, or that we've all come from and will return to source, is doing themselves, you know, just a great disservice. There is order. There is divine order, divine perfection that is operating everything in the universe. And to live in the faith of that is the greatest gift that we can give ourselves, truly.
Right.
And go ahead.
What I was going to say is, with you knowing that divine truth and experiencing it and sharing it with the audience and myself at this time, which is greatly appreciated, but you had that peace because you were, I'm going to call it, your part of you was incorporated into what you were experiencing in the
sure.
universe at that time. I'm talking as the ether, you know, the spirit, the physical body was down below. But
right.
at the same time, you had, you were true to yourself. It's like, what happens when a person is not true to themselves, let alone experiencing this experience, but it's basically like fudging, you know, not telling the truth as well as it is, or basically a little white lie to yourself, it can have, I'm going to call it a distorted effect.
Sure.
Not necessarily because of what you believe and what you had. You know that it is because it is that way. But if that person had not, I'm going to say, cleared that self of themselves as by fudging or any of that aspect, they may have a distorted experience, would you think? Or no, it would go all the way to divine.
You know,
self.
That's hard to say because so many people have written books about their near-death experiences, and some of them actually have stated that they've gone to hell. They've seen demons. They had something horrible happen to them. So I think you're very right in that the experience you have could very well reflect where you are spiritually at the time of the experience.
Right. If you're what I'm trying to say, Kathryn, is if you're physically in the mindset, in your consciousness, that you're in the realm of demons or are affected by that, and I know they do exist. I mean, things do exist out here in this world. But if you bite the bullet of not being higher than that, then it has a greater toll on you because it can go after you stronger because of those that commitment that you made. You made a not meaning you, but meaning that individual made a commitment to be controlled. I'm going to call it controlled by that stuff versus getting above it, as I always say.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I sort of took you a little off tangent, but not meaning to.
No, I understand exactly what you're saying. And I think also for a person who hasn't had a near-death experience, who doesn't understand that life is eternal, hadn't had the experience where they could grasp the great perfection of the universe, that's why people like myself and others who've gone through this can come back and say, learn from my experience. You know, even if you haven't had this experience yourself, the wise person learns from other people's experiences.
Right. You're the example. You're the physical example for the Creator's life here.
Exactly. And the other thing that I learned from that experience was not only that the afterlife was very real, that we are immortal, we are infinite and eternal, is the importance of being of good cheer in everything that happens in our life. And that was infused in me during that time. I've always been a very optimistic person, a very happy person. But it came home that the nature of spirit is joy, and that, therefore, is our essence as well. And no matter what confronts us in life, it's very important that we take it on with good cheer, that we endeavor to do whatever we're doing with joy, whether it's decorating the Christmas tree or overcoming financial tragedies, you know.
Or preparing for a deposition.
Yes.
Take it with cheer, you know.
That's it. Do it cheerfully. We can't always control what's happening to us, but we can control the way we respond to it. And by being of good cheer, and I had someone tell me once years ago that the great Master Jesus said that 17 times in the New Testament, be of good cheer. Because when we give in to doubt and worry and fear and anger, resentment, any of those lower vibration emotions, we are actually constructing a wall between ourselves and the outcome that we hope for, or ourselves and that which we desire.
Right,
so,
and you can box yourself in.
Oh, sure.
I didn't mean to speak over you, but
No. Please,
you box
anytime.
Yourself in. You wall yourself in, and then you're just this hard, calloused thing, you know? And you got to be, cheerful. I mean, a lot of things, everybody goes through sadness and times of darkness and, despair, et cetera, this way. But it's where you can always have a happy soul. And I've always took it serious, this aspect. I always, you have a guardian angel with you from the time of the beginning. And if their food is only joy and happiness, if you're not joyful and happiness and of cheer, you must be starving them.
That's a very interesting perspective. I haven't heard that before, but you're absolutely right. When we confront anything or meet anything with that spirit of cheer, we are guaranteed, I believe, the most positive outcome. And when we understand, as I do from my near-death experience, that everything is designed for our highest good, that everything is designed to take us to the highest that is possible for us in this lifetime, then with good cheer, we get there even that much quicker.
Right. That's the icing on the cake. That's the thing that makes the grease, it is the grease to make it go.
Yes, exactly. So with that being of good cheer, we're always looking for that silver lining. We're not being distracted by the stormy clouds or the raindrops. We know there's a silver lining. After every storm, the sun is going to shine. It has to, and it's going to happen in our lives so much quicker if we just remain of good cheer.
Right. And
so that was
what I was going to add to it is, if you recognize in yourself to create this silver lining so that it is of cheer and joy, you have to realize that aspect of yourself, of the God within, is what is out there, just as you experience in these regressions, but meaning of near-death experiences, that is like your little seed. That is your key to the bigger picture, the bigger consciousness. And, everybody can be a wet mop sometimes, but you don't need to be,
Exactly.
Get a new hairdo and change the book, you know?
Absolutely. I have a sign that hangs in my kitchen, and my grandmother used to say it to me. She said, "Honey, just put on a little lipstick, everything's fine." You know,
I had it at black.
Little red lipstick, and you're ready to go.
I thought it was the neatest thing when I was growing up. I had two aunts, and on my mother's side, and I used to love to watch makeup. My cousin Mary Grace and her girlfriend Lorraine, they had those big bat eyes, you know, and everything. I thought it was the neatest thing when I was 6 years old to watch them put makeup on. But, you know, my Aunt Blanche would say, "Hey, Hildy, I'm going to put my war paint on." You know, so I always think of that every time, you know. So it is, you know, getting ready for battle, put some lipstick on.
That's right. That's right. Dress up and get ready for the next miracle, because it's going to come.
That's it.
I remember hearing Maya Angelou say that as she gets older, she realizes that you don't have to be a pain just because you're in it. And I think that can go for any kind of pain that we're experiencing, not just in our body, but, you know, in our emotional life, in our spiritual life. You don't have to be a pain just because you're in it. So if we can just be of good cheer, it's almost like you can feel that energy, that good cheer, that joy, that expecting the best, that anticipation kind of floats you above whatever problem that you're being confronted by, whatever challenge that you're meeting. You just kind of float above it and drift over it, and before you know it, it's done. It's done. And from that elevated position, you can look down and actually see the gift, because every challenge is offering us a gift as well.
Right. Every challenge offers the gift. Don't look at it as a hardship or a deterrent. Learn from it, go above it and beyond it, and recognize it as a blessing.
Absolutely, absolutely. Number four on my list is, we're at number three, aren't we?
Number three.
Is truthfulness. Excuse me, I've got a barking dog. I'm so sorry.
It's okay.
I thought she was,
we needed
she
that.
Was
we needed that memory. We needed that energy on this line. Someone out there on this world needs the barking of a dog to have happiness.
Well, that's Mimsy the miniature dachshund. So,
dachshunds
number three.
Are good. I like them.
Oh, she's wonderful. She's just she's a wire hair, and she's got this little mohawk right down the middle from tail to her nose. Number three is truthfulness, and I believe personally it is imperative, not optional, that we come from 100% honesty in all of our actions, dealings, and conversations. I remember reading years ago in the book The Four Agreements, Don Miguel Ruiz called it being impeccable with your word. And I just can't emphasize this enough. You know, how often do we fool ourselves as to what honesty really means? And we compromise our integrity sometimes on a daily basis with little white lies that we think are inconsequential. But since we know the universe is always watching, always listening, there can be no untruth that's inconsequential. And it's like getting a call from a telemarketer and saying, you know, "Well, we'd like to speak with Kathryn Peters-Brinkley, please." And I say, "Oh, I don't want to deal with this. She's not in right now." You know, just so quickly we could say that. But it's just as easy to say, you know, "What is this call about? Please take me off your list." That's an integrity. And if you're doing something like that every day, that accumulates, that energy accumulates. And you don't need that in your space. You don't need that in your aura. It's like, I remember when my kids were in elementary school and we had to write notes to the teacher. And oftentimes I just like to take them with me when I lectured or when I traveled. And they'd say, "Well, I don't think that's going to be an excuse. Just tell them I had tonsillitis, Mom, or tell them I had a cold or whatever." And I'd say, "No, we can't do that. You know, it's just as important to me that you be with me and you make this trip, and I'm going, you know, to write in the note that we traveled to New York City or whatever, because I am teaching them to be in integrity." And especially for parents out there, it's so important to realize that your children learn what they live, and they are constantly watching what you do. You are the model of their lives. And if you are living in spiritual integrity, you are teaching them to live in spiritual integrity, no longer can we live by that old saying, do what I do, not do what I say, not what I do. That just isn't going to fly anymore. You know, not where we are, not as far advanced as we've become, and where we're traveling to galactic center. Something like that can no longer be tolerated. You have to set the example for your children. And they were sent here as special blessings that you are to be the initial guardian of, and you must guard their innocence, their truthfulness, and their spiritual integrity first.
And that's so true. It's the most precious gift, and their cheerfulness in their life, it's guarding them and being the watcher of, because their most precious thing is their soul. And it's like, you know, we started the show even bringing out Atlantis and Plato, but Plato said many things, you know, as quotes, and many mankind mm-hmm. has quoted him. But in relation to truthfulness, he had a quote, and I'm going to read it to you. False words are not only evil in themselves, but they infect the soul with evil.
Mm.
So to me, that's, again, confirmation of what you said. Be 100% truthful to yourself and to the world that you're in.
It's so very important. And another thing I'd like to add to that, that quote is, one of the things, and I think it's farther down in my list, but I think it behooves us to talk about it now. When we talk about evil in our words, gossip. Gossip is the one thing that I think is probably the most evil thing that we can do or perpetuate. When we don't know something to be true and we pass it on, this has to be eliminated in everyone's life. You know, and some things, even if they are true, it is kinder not to speak of them.
Right. If you can't, it's like they say, old saying, if you can't say anything good, don't say anything at all.
Exactly. And to embellish stories, you know that game we used to play as kids where we'd sit in a circle and one person would whisper to the next person
mm-hmm.
something, a sentence, and by the time the 10th person had came back to the end of the circle, it's a completely different story. So it's very, very important that we don't spread gossip. Unless we know the facts, don't talk about it. And certainly if it would be harmful to someone else, don't do it, because that kind of evil is very hard to get over or to get around. So
and you feel it, Kathryn. Like if you say a little lie where you've always told the truth, you feel that little tug at your heart.
Yeah,
and then it gets bigger, and it gets bigger, and it's bigger. And then when you open your heart, as you cleanse your heart from a spiritual side, when that talon comes off, just like if an eagle or a bird, you know, rips your heart, you feel it. You know, some of the people may be going through 8 hours of crying, you know, because it's mourning what were things that could have changed or done or whatever. It's just cleansing it out. And sometimes you might have flashes in your mind as you're getting that monkey chatter less, is as it's going out, you're seeing what those images were. Everyone has it different, and everyone experiences it differently. But as you said, and using yourself as an example with your near-death experiences, and out of body, you are the example of showing that and expressing what is on the other side. You know, it's only separated by a veil, and that veil is getting close, you know. And it's usually around holiday seasons that the ancestors and the closeness gets closer.
Absolutely, absolutely. Anytime we go into times of great celebration, they draw near. Because the sound of laughter and the celebration of joy and, you know, and the spirit of giving draws them very, very close to us. And remember, you know, the other side is just a breath away. And if you don't believe it, just hold yours long enough.
Yeah,
right?
That's true. When you pass all the colors and it goes black, definitely.
There you are.
Yeah, it is. That's a very good quote, Kathryn. You're only a breath away from the other side.
That's right.
So,
but this issue of truthfulness, I can't emphasize it enough. And not only, you know, to be a model of truthfulness with our children, because that's where it starts, but with our partners, with our husbands, and with our wives, we have to let those that close to us be assured that we have their back 100%. And whatever we say to them, whatever we promise, we come through.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, we undermine the integrity of those intimate relationships. And if that occurs too often, then we crack the foundation of our love. And we just don't want that to happen. So every little white lie we tell, it makes it easier for us to tell the next one and the next one until they're bigger lies and they're darker lies. And this can have no place in our lives as we go through this shift and this ascension into higher realms of consciousness. There's just no place for it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
so it's very important that we get into the practice now of always telling the truth, no matter what the consequences. Because if we're coming from spiritual integrity, there really aren't going to be any negative consequences to being authentic.
Right. That's the truth. And if you say it and you practice what you preach, the consequences of not sharing the truth are far less.
Exactly. So we do what we say. We say what we mean. And no, how does it go?
You look the look.
Say what you mean.
Talk.
Oh, yeah. Say what you mean. Mean what you say, and do what you say you're going to do. It's
right.
Real simple. It's so simple. It's when we are dishonest that we have to remember what we said.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
yeah.
Or make
and try to keep
for
all
why
the
we
lies
didn't do
straight.
It. Oh, my God, it's not worth it. It's not worth it. And we don't have time for that now. There's too many more important things that we have to attend to, you know, as we reach Galactic Center. And the next thing that I had on my list is paying attention, staying conscious, and living in the now. So many of us, because our lives have become so fragmented, so chaotic, because we have so much on our plate every day to deal with, because we haven't learned how to say no, but that's a whole different show, is that we're coming from knee-jerk responses. We're on autopilot. We're going through the day like, you know, automatons, instead of taking time to do some deep breathing, be in the moment, and be present with one another.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're not even doing it at meals anymore.
Oh,
in my
right.
family, the whole world stops at dinner time. Everybody's at the table. The television's off. Don't dare bring your cell phones with you. You know, we turn on a little sweet music. We light some candles. And this is an hour where we are going to spend listening to one another, being present with one another fully and completely. And I encourage families to do more of that.
Right, because a lot of it is breaking down in the family where the best time is sitting at that table and listening to the jokes or whatever is going on, because that's your day that everybody's there, and the time, rather, that everybody's there.
Yes.
And now it's each one goes in their own room, each one does their own thing.
Someone's
versus,
in front of the TV, yeah.
Right, not wanting to participate. So it's so important anymore that way.
It is so important. And not even in your own family. I mean, there are things that we do at the table every night. You know, I go around, what did you learn today? Everybody is required to learn something new every day. You know, even if you have to look up a fact before you come to the table on the internet, it's just important that, you know, we keep learning. And I have instilled that in my children. You know, I'm still learning. I want you to learn something new every day. And so they have to bring that with them to the table at night. And knowing that that's expected, it keeps their minds open and curious. So, you know, whatever your little traditions are in your family, or if you don't have any, create them. And, of course, before we eat, we always say our blessing. We always thank Great Spirit for the food. We always bless one another. We bless the planet. We pray for peace. We infuse the food with whatever is necessary to nourish our bodies. These things are important, but you have to stay in the now. You have to stay in the now. Connect the dots. look into the face of a stranger, you know, what a smile can do, what a compliment
That's true.
Can
and
do
they usually
in the
smile
lives
back.
Of other people.
Yeah.
Yeah. But, you know, you have no idea what that person is going through. Maybe they're feeling completely isolated in life and that no one cares. And you walk down the street and being very present with this person who is passing you. How often do you just walk by? You don't make eye contact. You don't say hello. But if you are conscious and staying in that moment as that person walks by and you smile and say, hello, have a nice day, or even bless them silently, they're going to feel that too.
Right,
but
right, because you will feel it, yes.
Oh, they will feel it. They will feel it. And so doing little things like that that keep you conscious to the moment makes all the difference in the world and continually adds to your spiritual integrity.
Yeah, and that is so important. And now with, what do we have for number five?
One more thing about paying attention. At the end of every day, I encourage everyone to take stock of the day, take an inventory, you know, have a daily life review. What did I do really well today? Where did I kind of fall short? But tomorrow I can, you know, make a new choice to do that better. What did I learn today? What were the high points? What am I grateful for most today? It's important to do that. And I suggest that you journal it. But even if you just lie in bed and have that inventory in your mind, it really will make the difference on how you live the next day.
Right. It's how you close that day.
Yes.
You know, by the reflection of that day. Thus, you open a new beginning in the morning.
Exactly. Our next one is commitment to goodness. Okay. I think in life, it goes along with spiritual integrity, hand in hand, that we know exactly what we stand for in life and what we will not stand for, and that we make a commitment to goodness, that in everything we do, we are thinking about the greater good of everyone concerned. It's no more, it's all about me. We can't think that way anymore. We are all in this together. And we always have to consider other people in the choices that we make, in the decisions that we make, and in the actions that we take. Our thoughts and intentions must be committed to the perpetuation of goodness for all concerned.
Yeah, because so many people can compromise, meaning tell that lie, compromise in your work or professional judgment or anything, and then it has its due consequence at the end. So if you always do it consistently as seeing it black and white or anything, I'm not saying that there's no gray out there, but if you do your profession or your work that way, then you don't get in these compromising situations or anything like that, that then you have the regret of your soul or the spiritual side of yourself.
Well, you know, when we know what we stand for, then it's really easy to make decisions, isn't it? If we're constantly vacillating on what we think is important in life or what we stand for, then it's easy for people to think, well, he's kind of flip-flopping. He's all over the place. You can't depend on him because you never know where he stands. But and it's not that you're not going to change your mind on some things. Your belief system can be very different from mine, but if I know what you stand for, I respect your integrity, right?
Right, exactly. Like you're number three. When you're truthful and you know this person to always be 100% honest all the time, you have no question in your mind of their honesty.
Exactly. You know that when you go to them for their opinion or when you ask them to do something for you, you can take it to the bank. It's done.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because they've proven their integrity. And so when we commit to goodness and people know that that is part of our spiritual integrity, it's never going to be, well, gosh, is this guy going to screw me or is she going to talk behind my back or anything like that. You don't have to worry about that. You know that their commitment is to goodness and justice, what is righteous and noble in the world.
Right. And the thing is, many people have like even approached me, and they say, well, can't you think like that? Or that? I go, no, because I don't think anything bad. How can I think about anything? No. I mean, I know bad things exist out there and that, but it's not on my watch, you know, creating the bad. I'm trying to always correct the bad. But the thing is, you know, even for souls out there that are honest with themselves and truthful, et cetera, this way, there's many souls out there, maybe we can only count them on our hand, but I hope there's a lot more than that, that they can't even think deviant because that's not their nature.
Exactly.
Because
so they
made that commitment to honesty from before birth.
I agree. I agree. I think that is a choice we made before we came. And I know for me, I've had many people in my life say, oh, my God, you're just too idealistic. You're too innocent. You walk around with rose-colored glasses. You don't see the world the way it really is, Kathryn. You see it the way you want it to be. Well, that's probably true. And because of that, I don't see a lot of evil things that come my way because my mind doesn't work that way that I could even discern this coming before it got here.
Mm-hmm.
But I wouldn't want to change, and I don't think you would either, Dr.
Oh, No. I'm not changing.
No.
And don't
I can't do that.
No, I don't.
I can't do that.
Change. I'm not compromising. I'm not anything. You may not agree with me or anything. That's your choice. That's your commitment. But I'm doing it the way I've done from the beginning of my life, you know. And I've had good teachers along the way, you know. Whether it's your parents, your grandparents, just as you've had aunts and uncles that put on war paint or any of this thing. The thing is, there were good examples. And all families have obstacles and that, but it's a blessing when you can look at it and laugh and realize that was the choices. As I took one psychology class in school a long time ago, and the professor said, do you realize, to the whole class, there's about 100 people in the class, and they go, you are the results of all the mistakes your grandmothers made.
Wow.
You know, that's sort of heavy when you think about it, but at the same time, get past that, you know?
Yeah. Well, this is the thing. I think it's in the Bible. It says the sins of the father are passed down to 8 generations or something.
Yes,
and you
yes.
just make up your mind that you're where the buck stops.
Right.
It's not going any further. I'm eliminating
it.
Those.
That's
yeah.
it.
I'm breaking the pattern.
Right. And you are like the like I have it even in my book, the last representative. Once you make that commitment, you're helping everyone on the other side that couldn't get it through, even if it was 5,000 years ago from the, you know, your first bloodline or anything. The thing is, you're making a commitment to change it, and this is the way my universe wants it because I fit into the bigger universe, and this is the way I'm running my ship over here.
Exactly. So when we make that commitment to goodness, we also make that commitment to excellence in our lives. At any given moment, we are going to do the very best that we can. And we can only determine that by the level of spiritual integrity that we have achieved. But to do the very best in any given moment means that the next moment will be even better and better and better.
Right, right, right. And that because it is needed, and it's going to happen, audience. Because this show, I hope everyone listens to, and when it's archived and that, because you're going to need this in the next 12 months. And there is even a beautiful book to even get it, which we're going to have as a prize on this meeting, which is your book. I always give a prize for every show
wonderful.
A question. So the question is, name one of the 10 spiritual integrity top 10 important things to remember, as quoted by Miss Kathryn Peters-Brinkley. And then they will win a copy of your book and our Portals to Destiny gels. So I think it's important not only for a gift at the Christmas time, but at the same time that you listen to these because we're not going to let Atlantis blow up like they did last time. The Lemurians are going to come out. And, you know, I still worry, and I'll discuss that with Mr. Tom Horn next week on artificial biology. What happened to those 150 million eggs that they inoculated with the animal genes? We're not going to have no cyclops or anything like that. What's going on? But that's a whole other story of life, you know, because all in the name is science. But science has a spiritual side, my dear, you know?
It does.
And that's what
it does.
We are. I had a good friend that said years ago to me, and he was top scientist, even reported to presidents of the world and everything. He said, "Hilda, there's black and white, and I got so close to black that I'm almost black, but I'm gray, you know." But he said, "I'm turning it over to you, you know." And I said, "Okay." So it's on my watch now, world, and you know, I'm planting good seeds, you know.
Yes,
not for
you
me,
are
but
for
all of us are planting
for
the
all
humanity
of us. I love
seedlings.
I love the saying that life is not black and white. It's just many beautiful hues of gray.
I love that.
Yeah.
Marshall would love that.
And that's a great way to live and to see all the beautiful hues. Everybody doesn't have to think exactly like we do.
Mm-hmm.
But when it comes to spiritual integrity, everyone needs, you know, to live in that, no matter what hue of gray they decide to be. As long as we're all living in integrity, let it go. What a beautiful color show.
Right.
I don't
beautiful
remember
color.
which
you
which
were on number
we're
you're
on.
Going on to number 6. The last one was number 5, commitment to goodness. Now we're
okay.
on number 6.
And let's make that commitment to goodness and to excellence. And so number 6 is assume responsibility for your life. Assume complete responsibility for your life, no matter what you're experiencing. Know that you chose to do so. Everything that happens to us is designed for our growth and evolution. And many times, people that come into our lives and show us lessons that we don't think are that favorable or we really don't want to learn, remember that some of our greatest teachers come to show us what not to do.
Right.
But no matter, go ahead.
But what I was going to say, even some of those teachers, you may hate them the most in this lifetime,
mm-hmm.
but they were the ones that were the greatest teachers for you for the spiritual side.
Absolutely. Absolutely. There's no doubt about it. Any challenge, I think any challenge that is present in our lives is here to offer us a higher understanding. But blame, anger, resentment, any of that, any of those lower vibrational energies or emotions are going to keep us from seeing what the challenge came to teach us. So if we take responsibility, we don't blame anybody else for what's going on, we don't resent anyone else, we don't get crazy angry over this inconvenience or this obstacle in our path, and we just take responsibility for it, sit down and go within, go back to our meditation, prayer, and affirmation, we will find the gift.
Right.
We will grow accordingly, and we will be stronger as a result.
Correct. And remember, audience, as you get stronger, you become the steel, the tempered steel, and become your own sword, which can be pure love.
Remember what I said, we are here to be the essence and presence of love.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to do away with all of the things that mask us as love. I mean, love is not an emotion. It is our state of being. It is our essence, and we're trying to peel back all the layers that have veiled that from our conscious mind and higher heart. Not our higher heart. Our higher heart always knew we were love. But
yeah.
There are certain aspects of our beingness that has forgotten who we are. And all of the things that we've talked about today are steps that we take to remember who we are, to open ourselves to our divine beingness, and to see only love, give only love, feel only love. So we talked about the daily assessment. So are we on to number 7 now?
We're on number 7 now.
Okay. This, I think we touched on earlier because I talk about no gossip, but it's watching every thought and word that we utter, okay? Every thought we think and every word we utter. It is so important that we monitor and discipline our minds to be as positive and as kind, compassionate and loving as we can in our communications, not only with ourselves, but with the world around us.
Yes.
For ourselves, our life is going to go in the direction of our most predominant thoughts. So if we're thinking every day, and I know you, I'm sure you've talked about this before. We all know people who say things like, I am so sick and tired of this.
Yeah.
Really? Well, if you keep saying that, guess what? You're going to get even more sick and even more tired, right?
Right.
Little things like that that are almost habitual. And we're back to taking our lives off autopilot. We have to do it in the thoughts that we think and the things that we say. Look at your language. How often are you saying, I can't? If you know, just strike that. You can do anything.
Right.
You know, I will do this.
And the first thing is, quote, unquote, I don't have any money. You just said it to the universe. You won't have any money. So get
past that,
you know.
That's right.
You have abundance. You have all the currency, which is money and electricity and everything, that you need. And you will have more that is needed to allow you to shop through the kingdom of man, you know. So it will do that. But you need definitely to watch, as you said, every thought and word you utter. Because thoughts, if you have bad thoughts and you send it out, your ESP will zap it out there, and it's going to go into chaos and make other lives extremely upside down.
Exactly. And so you can influence your health, as I told at the very beginning with my affirmations and my condition with MS. You can increase the abundance in your life, whether it's wealth, health, your prosperity, your friendships, your relationships, all relationships. You know, Krishnamurti, I loved reading his book so much, and the one thing that has stuck with me after all these years is his saying, life is relationships. Whether it's your relationship to your God, your relationship to yourself, or your relationship to others. And so you have to really cultivate those relationships with tenderness, love, and care. And one of the best ways to do that is through the words that you utter, whether they're words of encouragement, tenderness, support, or the opposite, which we won't even go there, because why would you want to do that in your relationships? Why would you want to do anything that deters from someone else's magnificence, right?
Right.
But it's important to realize that your words have such power. They are living things filled with energy that is powerful enough to impact the life of another person, and certainly your own life. So make sure that every word, every thought is as uplifting, as full of encouragement as you can possibly make it, and filled with health and joy. And, you know, this is a perfect time for this program, Dr. Hildy, as you were saying, because it is the holiday season. And for those of us who celebrate Christmas, it's not just the birth of the Christ that we celebrate, but the birth of Christ consciousness in all of us.
Correct.
And everything we've talked about today is an aspect of Christ consciousness.
Mm-hmm.
So for people who are hearing this program or who will hear it in the future, just see this as your own birth, a rebirth of your own Christ consciousness, and use these on a daily basis to help you augment that higher vibration of Christ consciousness. So number eight, are we there?
Yes.
Number eight?
Great.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is watch what you put into your mind. Be very careful of the things that you allow your mind to absorb. And without being unkind or meaning to be unkind in any way, I think a lot of times, turn off the TV. Stop watching the Kardashians. And I bless them and love them as a sacred family that they are. But when we watch things like this, if I don't know if you've ever seen the program, I have, because I have five daughters and a son.
I flip right through it.
Yeah.
I watch movies.
The things that come out of their mouths are just unbelievable. And but they have an audience of millions of people who are being influenced by this kind of commentary on American life. And I think it is important. Watch good, great, uplifting movies. Watch the History Channel.
Mm-hmm.
What else is wonderful? National Geographic. There are so many things that we can watch that uplift our spirits, you know, and
watch
and
our old
minds.
Shows, too, because you'll learn
Absolutely.
A lot. I like
Absolutely.
It with the movie.
And as I begin every day with my affirmations, I have books around the house everywhere, you know, that I can pick up and read an uplifting story, you know, the Daily Word from the Unity Church or any of the books that so many are out there that we could recommend. But just make sure that you're constantly feeding your mind and soul with the good news, with uplifting thoughts, with timeless universal principles, and then you can't go wrong. Get away from the television. Get away from the computer.
Right.
Go outside and be in nature. You know,
mm-hmm.
do something wonderful for a neighbor. Do something anonymous that improves the life of someone else.
Mm-hmm.
All of these things are filling your heart, mind, and soul with spiritual integrity.
Right. And number nine.
I hope that you agree. I don't know what your stance on this, but for me, it's eating living foods.
Oh, I love it.
Okay?
Yes, that definitely.
And, yeah. Okay. I mean, you know, as much as you possibly can, at least 80% of your diet, fresh fruits and vegetables, organic, well prepared, beautifully displayed. You know, presentation is everything. But what is more appetizing and delicious than a beautiful living salad filled with every type of vegetable you can think of? And part of living foods for me is not only elevating my personal vibration because I'm not putting dead animals into my body, but it's also bringing, at least on my part, harmlessness to the world because I don't want to contribute to the cruelty of animals. They're very
mm-hmm.
important to me. And I think everyone needs to at least think about this. I know everyone isn't going to give up eating meat, but if they can cut down and they can make sure that they've been, you know, free range. All
right.
These
and that there are real meat because now there's no labels. You know, forget irradiation on the foods, but you don't even know if you're getting, you know, mycoprotein from a fungus for a chicken nugget versus a cloned steak made in a mold, you know.
That is just
it's wild times.
Mind.
It's wild times. I tell you, some. I mean, it's past the wars of sheep and cattle. You know, of 100 years of cattle and sheep barons. But it's wild times now.
Wild times, and of course, if we can get out and we can grow our own food,
yes.
I mean that is even better. If we can get our hands in the earth and plant those seeds and water them and love them and talk to them. Whenever I have a garden, I go out every day and I talk to them, touch them. They love the human energy,
mm-hmm.
You know, in a very gentle and loving way. And of course, we can plant a garden. We can plant some beautiful trees, nut trees and fruit trees, and this is even better for us if we can do it ourselves. If we can find the seeds and we have the space, I definitely recommend that everybody do it. Even if they just have a little herbal garden in their kitchen window,
mm-hmm.
just to watch, you know, living things like that come up and be able to take the basil or the oregano and put it in their spaghetti sauce, you know, from right there in their window.
Right.
These things truly elevate the spirit.
They do elevate the spirit, Kathryn, and at the same time, you can always plant edible flowers and have very nice salads or appetizers throughout the year. And also, as you incorporate flowers or any of the other, I'm going to say, colors of edible foods, you will find that you really eat less of them and you're more fulfilled because of what those higher nutrients that are within them and their absorbability in the body. But it's the time where we have to eat lower level of food, by lower level of food meaning like a plant, et cetera, versus a higher food would be an animal or a cow, that way. Because times are unique.
I know
they're wild.
They are. They truly are. And I know we're running out of time. And the last thing, number 10 on my list, is volunteering to do charity work. Okay? Of whatever kind appeals to you, but doing something for someone else less fortunate. Whether it's going to Big Brother and Sister and being a mentor, volunteering time at the hospital to read to people, or in pediatrics to hold the babies, there is always something that you can do. I know my girls went on Thanksgiving and helped to feed the homeless at one of the churches in town. Little things like this make the hugest difference in other people's lives and in our lives. So I think it's very important to give of our time for no compensation, expecting nothing in return, just to give from an open heart to people who are less fortunate. Makes all the difference.
They do. They do. And to recap, because of the time, Kathryn, and I'm not rushing you, I can go on forever with you, I just want to read back to the audience what you did, what you stated as the 10 spiritual integrity, 10 important things to remember by Kathryn Peters-Brinkley. Number one, prayer, meditation, and affirmations. Number two, have faith and good cheer. Number three, truthfulness. Be 100% honest. Four, pay attention and live in the now. Five, commit to goodness and excellence. Number six, assume complete responsibility for your life. Number seven, watch every thought and word you utter. Number eight, watch what you put into your mind. Number nine, eating living foods. Number 10, volunteer to do charity work, no matter what
That's
the charity
it.
Is.
No matter what the charity is.
Yeah, and the charity
it
can even
really
be, you know, helping your community or anything.
Absolutely. Absolutely. In any way. Something that you give for no pay, expecting nothing in return, except to make the life of someone else a little brighter and a little better.
Right, and your community aspect of it. Kathryn, I want to thank you very, very much for being on my show. I wish you a great holiday season and a blessed 2012 as we approach it. And I know your core energy will be centered as we go through the galactical changes. And I want to tell the audience, please, look at these 10 important things and start one by one changing within your life, and you will see the blessings come to you that much faster. And God bless to everyone.
Informed, enlightened, alive and amplified. This is the Living Light Network.